trying at the beginning, like Riz, part of Riz's pitch was that I didn't need to change anything in the script. It was quite developed by that point. And I was half convinced by what he said. And I knew where, like he's always trying to find projects that aren't written for the South Asian male. And I think he very quickly in his acting career got bored of doing those projects, playing a terrorist, playing, you know, whatever the other cliche is of a South Asian actor. And so he's always looking for the role, you know, like Sound of Metal wasn't written for him. Other actors passed on the project and it came to him and he really fought for it. And he wants to play roles that could be universal. But then once I cast him on the project and we will work on the character a bit, we both felt it would be like disingenuous to the material if there was no mention, or his ethnicity didn't play a part at all. In fact, the character's name initially stayed the same, which was Marcus, and the kid's name stayed the same, and the wife's name stayed the same. And we were like, this is weird now, because we worked on it for a couple of months. We were not rewriting together, but just kind of going through the script together. And we thought, we don't want this film to erase the character's ethnicity. It should be cognizant of the character's ethnicity, but we also didn't want his ethnicity to be such the dominant theme that, one, it overtook this being a father-son story and a mental health story, and two, maybe we were both a bit reticent that just because you're a person of colour, you know, that means every time you play a film, your ethnic identity is going to be the main prism through which people experience your character. You're always going to play a fish out of water, or you're always going to be a person of colour in a white dominant culture. We thought it can play a part, but we could be nuanced in the way that we did it. And so a little bit of rewriting on some of the scenes where I wanted race or racism to play a part, but for it to be a bit more, not like subliminal, but just subtle. So that if you were a smart audience, you could read into maybe why one of the FBI agents was being overly dismissive to Octavia Spencer's character, or you know why the state trooper stopped, you know, doesn't say anything explicitly racist to Riz's character, but you know, it's playing a part in their power dynamic. But you didn't think, okay, now that Riz is apart, lots of these other characters are going to say really explicit racist shit. It just seemed like too on the nose. So they were like the nuances, and then Riz was just, he's always like, he's very good collaborator for a director, because he probably will direct at some point. He's very in tune to the grit, like the director's process. So I felt like we could talk through the script together, and he would also comment on areas that he wasn't, in scenes that he wasn't featured in. And there was just lots of little, calibrations to a lot of scenes that came from discussions with him without doing a kind of ground one, rewrite.
And I guess in the casting process for his boys, who are amazing in the film as well, I guess having him involved in the casting process for that, and I guess chemistry tests, that was crucial to the success of it, really. How did you go about casting them? Had they worked in film or TV before, or how did you go about that?
Yeah. Auditions for a kid from Brooklyn, from the middle of Texas, from Montana, Canada, Nevada. I was a bit worried at the beginning about accents, because it's very hard for a kid to lose their accent. But we were just trying to find the right kids, and that was almost like a future problem. If I found the most unbelievable kid from Louisiana, you know, I just try and, I might even rewrite the character's background, you know, that they move forward. Riz would have to have a southern accent to fit that kid if the kid was right. And I also made the decision that we'd go try and cast kids that didn't have to have been in a film before, you know, they didn't even need to have acted before. So the older one was from Canada, he'd been in one or two Canadian, local Canadian TV shows, never been in a film before. The younger one, never acted before. I mean, maybe, I think he'd been in a school play. We couldn't really do any in-person chemistry. I couldn't go meet them because of COVID. They couldn't meet each other. So I had to sort of rely on partly their auditions and how good they were over Zoom, but which is always hard for an actor because they're self-taping a lot, or even when you're on Zoom with them, you know, the little one was, Aditya was only 7, I think, when he did his auditions. It was really hard for, you know, obviously like a kid of that age to concentrate on screen, you know, their attention's kind of everywhere. So I kind of thought I'm going to partly cast them for their acting ability, but partly just on getting to know them and what my instinct told me about them as people. And if I could find a really strong connection with them, as if I could become but really close buddies with them quite quickly. If I had a good connection, then I had a strong instinct that they would connect with each other, they both connect with this. So I did eventually get Aditya and Lucy River to do a chemistry test with each other. But it was really awkward because it was over Zoom. There was probably like 12 other people watching it. We were of course like invisible. And I was there at the beginning saying, hey, I want you to meet Future, you guys might be playing brothers together. And I didn't tell them it was a chemistry Zoom, not that they would know what that was. I was just like, oh, I want you guys to hang out for a bit. And then I went, you know, I took away my screen on Zoom. And me and the casting directors and all the producers were watching. And it was like so awkward for 2 minutes because they didn't know what to do, but they kind of knew that they were being watched somehow and it was important. It was just like one kid asking the other, like, you know, what's your favorite color? And then they'd do like a long silence, and the other one would go, blue, what's yours? And it was like that level of conversation. And I just thought, either I set this up wrong, or these kids aren't right. And then one of them started talking about some game that they play a lot of, called Beyblades, which I've never heard of. But it's like a cartoon, I don't know if people know about this. And then they spoke about that for like an hour. I couldn't shut them up, and they became like close friends. And so once I'd seen that, I knew, you know, I joined Riz for a bit then, I had a strong instinct that, sorry, is this me? I had a strong instinct that he would connect with them. I didn't feel like I needed to put Riz through a chemistry read with the kids. He's such a warm guy, I knew he could make it work. If he was an actor that I thought was maybe a bit colder emotionally, or I struggled to connect with it, I might have done it just to see it, but I didn't have any doubt that he would be quite a paternal presence. Yeah. In the film.
I am going to open the questions up very soon, so if you start to think about anything you might want to ask, I will come to you in a minute. I just want to bring things back a little bit into, I guess, being a student here and ask something which I usually ask people, which is, what is your grad film and what was that process like?
What's your grad film?
Yeah.
It was called Isaac and Ellen, and it was, I don't think it's online anywhere. I think I've got one VHS tape in a cupboard somewhere, and so even if I did get it transcoded, it would also look like garbage. I don't know if I'll ever share that
with us.
Yeah, I mean, maybe at the film school in an archive somewhere, they would have got it, I should ask them. But it was about a young kid who for some kind of punishment, he was sent to an old people's home to like help, you know, take care of the old people. And then he made a connection with a really old lady, and he started to understand hanging out with her that she was trying to commit suicide. And spoiling the film here, but you might never watch it. He helps her commit suicide. So he, even though he's a really I wouldn't say a bad kid, but he was a naughty kid. He committed an act of euthanasia for compassionate reasons. And I quite like the, there was some kind of strange irony in that. So I thought it was a good idea. It was relatively well executed for what my filmmaker abilities. There went to quite a few festivals and won a few awards, but I haven't watched it for like, I don't know, 15 years or something. So I might be watching and go, wow, that was actually okay for a 25-year-old me. Or I might watch it and go, oh my god,
that's very good.
Yeah.
No one should see it.
Yeah, let me know if they've got a copy.
Yeah. I know we do have our place somewhere, so.
Yeah, please do.
We'll have that. I'd like to open the floor up a bit to all of you. If any of you have any questions, I could talk all day to Michael, but if any of you have questions, chuck your hand up. Open the pick. I saw your hand up. Go on.
Speaking of being a student at AV and graduating, what were your aspirations and thoughts, like especially at, while graduating, like in level six or after graduation, to now? Have you, met them, exceeded them, and what was that journey?
I think I was just really focused on wanting to be a feature director. So, and I was close to graduation, I was trying to figure out next steps. And a lot of people that I was studying with were getting jobs in the industry. They were being runners or assistants in different production companies. And I didn't see how that was going to get me any closer to being a film director. So I just looked at a few directors that I admired and just kind of researched what their process, like how they got there, what were the stepping stones. And so one director I really liked was Lynn Ramsey, because I've been a big fan of her shorts, and I really liked Ratcatcher. Maybe she made more colour by that moment. And I saw that she went to the NFTS and she made a bunch of shorts there. So I was close to graduating, I just said to myself, well, that was the only option that I was going to follow, was go to the NFTS, make more shorts, even though this film, Isaac and Ellen, may or may not have, I don't know, I haven't seen it in a while, some qualities. I certainly felt like I had much further to go. Going to the NFTS meant that I could make more shorts. So I think I made another, I won some prize money from Isaac and Ellen, and I made another short. Sorry, I applied with Isaac and Ellen, didn't get into the NFTS. I don't know if it was that short or the interview wasn't good enough. So I stayed in Bournemouth for a year. I think I had like $5,000 or $6,000 in prize money, and I made another short by myself, and then a couple of other students over the year below, like a cinematography student and a sound student, and I cast local naughty kids at a bus shelter who lived near me. None of who wanted to be in the film, but I gave them £50 to turn up every day. I made another short that was better. It got me an interview at the NFTS, and then Lynn Ramsey interviewed me. I was like, oh, this is, I didn't tell her, but I was like, this is so weird, this is part of the reason I'm going here, but it's because she was the person I was trying, whose career I wanted to track. And so when I got into the NFTS, it was great, because it was 2 years of just making rock shorts. Now I suppose it's hard to think of yourself as like a film director, because I feel like I've only made two, and I always think maybe once you've made five, you feel like a legitimate film director. But I suppose still to like, make two along my way. It's good, they both had like released out of theatrical release, and this one obviously it's less so because it's with Amazon, but it's still out in cinemas here in the US. So far, so good.
Thank you.
All right.
Anyone else got a question here, or shall I jump in? Yeah,
my question is just, what was your thought process in kind of reconciling the various genres that Encounter is? Because, you at the start you said you don't think it's as much of a sci-fi. I've seen it's advertised as a sci-fi, but it is as much a kind of road movie or a neo-Western as that. So what was your kind of thought process there?
I think part of that was already in the DNA of the script that I originally wrote, and I didn't want, I felt like the film should embrace its hybrid genre identity. And maybe I have like a affection for films that are more than one thing in a way. Like I like, you know, I rewatched Mulholland Drive again the other week. I feel like I always return to that movie because I'm trying to understand it. Or, you know, I really like Parasite, you know, that won the Oscar a few years ago, because that's quite hard to pin down in terms of a genre. Whereas if something's like a kind of hard genre, like a straight horror, or I find it only engages me so much because I feel like I've seen a film go through those steps several times. So maybe, yeah, it's partly being attracted to material that is taking some kind of risk with how it shapes the genre. And I think also just, I guess my process was to try to stay close to the character. Like if it was, okay, I think the danger was if it was like a pastiche of different genres, and like the opening was scored like a sci-fi with lots of synths. And then as it became more of a thriller, it was a completely different type of score. And then at the end, when it's more of a drama, it's something else. And I thought the way to mitigate against that is if we're staying close to the character. And so, with it not really being a sci-fi, because ultimately it's not, you know, it's obviously like it's part of a psychotic episode that the character's happening, going through. I felt like using some of the language of sci-fi was an empathetic way to get inside the character's head. Because anyone that's going through, it struck me when I was doing research around mental health, that so many films put you into a very objective perspective. Like you, the audience, know that they're, like, quote, crazy, and you're at a distance from them. And I thought maybe there's a way to use genre to do a deep dive inside a character's head and to be more empathetic to them. Because anyone that's mentally unwell doesn't think they're unwell. They genuinely think that they're, you know, whatever the particular psychosis is, that they're being spied on by, you know, government forces, or that they are the next messiah. And so I thought, well, if we shift the film into his perspective at the beginning, then no matter what mistakes he makes along the way, we're still gonna feel for the guy, because he's not just, you know, there's another version of this film, which is a crazy guy kidnaps his kids for the weekend and the police hunt him down. And I felt like that would have kept you at a distance from him. Whereas I thought if we take his perspective, then that's not what's happened at the beginning. You're following a guy that's trying to save his kids from an imminent alien invasion. And even though later in the film we share other people's perspectives, like his parole officer, and his older son starts to see this discrepancy between what he's saying and what is actually going on, you still have the memory, you still remember what it was like to be in his head. And so, yeah, that was the, and then, yeah, with score and with the aesthetics of the film, we didn't try to make three different movies. We tried to bake in the language. Like the score, the last cue, is a lot of the same elements as the first cue, but we wanted it to be something that was kind of haunting at the beginning and something that was quite beautiful at the end. And so we were just trying to treat it as a whole, even though where the threat came from changes. So it's at the beginning the threat is aliens, and then it becomes him, and then it becomes law enforcement. But it's definitely a journey to navigate all of that with all of the heads of the department.
Was that moment of the revelation about me, did that always happen at the same point in the script, in the story? Or did that ever move closer to the end or further forward? Because it is kind of, is it 35, 40,
yeah,
40 minutes in? Was that a conscious decision there, or was it, do you ever think about pushing it kind of closer to the end?
Yeah, I think in Joe's script, you I don't know if you ever fully believed that it was happening beyond the first five pages or so, and then I thought there was a danger that you feel like the father was just blatantly lying to the kids. But then I didn't want to put it too late, because then it becomes like a kind of M. Night Shyamalan twist. Like, oh, you thought it was this thing, it's actually not. And that would undermine the film evolving into being a story about mental health and a son trying to help their dad, with compassion out of this crisis that they're going through. So my approach was, we had to do it relative long enough that you were like with the character, but not so late that you felt dramatically, you felt completely cheated and the story had further to go. So it was almost like building it into the premise. And it gave you enough time to be on the journey, and we'd hopefully, we laid down a few clues early on in the film that if you was really astute, or if you watch it for the second time, you go, oh, those are the signs. Of course, he was mentally unwell. And I felt if you pushed it too late, it becomes like a big, like a plot. The whole film is hinged on that plot twist,
yeah.
As opposed to it's just organically part of the premise.
And you spoke a minute ago as well about the aesthetics of the film, and you worked with the same DOP for Beast, is that right?
Yeah.
How did your visual language evolve with him in creating this film? Because there's definitely some moments where I think I could definitely see someone doing a great kind of parallels of the two films. You see the cop on the floor and then Jessie on the floor in Beast as well. How did the overall visual language change for this story?
I think we wanted a lot of Beast. Well, not a lot more than we intended to. A lot of this was handheld because we just had such a tight schedule, and so we just had to grab scenes quite quickly. I mean, we shot some whole scenes in one take, like one scene where Jesse's character is talking to a policeman. We had Ben, the DP, filming over her shoulder. We did it three times, but we couldn't cut because we didn't have the time to cut. DP, I said, okay, now run over to the policeman's shoulder, keep filming. We did it on him three times, and then maybe I told him to step backwards and do a wide, and then we cut. And so the editor just had 10 minutes of footage, and that was the scene. And with this one, we could be a lot more considered about where we put the camera, and we were, and some of that worked for Beast in a way, because it was, sometimes you're jammed and you have a restriction, whether it's time or budget, and it's your creative thinking can provide you with a solution that was better than if you, than an idea, if you planned it quite rigorously. But we wanted the film to kind of vacillate between having quite an observational approach, and so, which I really needed to do anyway, because the kids' performances I knew would change quite a lot. And I realized the younger kid, he was at his best when he was improvising. I'm not even sure how much he says in the film is from the script. And I didn't want to hem him in, because he could suddenly feel like the more he would repeat a line, the kind of sometimes the could start to feel like acting, and he was at his best when it's quite natural. So I tried to keep it quite observational, shot with two cameras so that they could integrate a lot of the improvisation that he does, because I could always cut to Riz or the older brother. But then when Riz was by himself, like in the motel room at the beginning, or when he goes to the branch's house to steal a car, me and Ben wanted a more like rigorous language, almost as if something was trying to convey the feeling that something is around the corner, or something is watching or following him. And I always find the films, if you have a very slow track behind the character or towards the character, or it's their POV slowly tracking forward, it elicits a sense of unease. And it would have been harder to create that unease about something following them or being around the corner if it was all observational. And so we that was a rule that it was a general approach. And we often broke that semi-rule if the scene just didn't feel right for it. So it's about giving it the space, but also it was who was in the scene. Because, yeah, if the kids were in the scene, we just tried to keep it quite simple and fussy. And if it was just Riz, it was much more controlled and focused.
And obviously you shot with Octavia Spencer as well. Very jealous. So Riz and Octavia, obviously they're both like top of their game actors. So they work in different ways, and how do you approach directing them in that regard as well? And did they ever actually, in the shooting schedule, did they ever cross over? Because they never share a frame?
No, they share a short scene, but they never, it was only once, one day.
Yeah.
Near the end where she gets on, she tries to de-escalate the situation and get them out of the car. And I remember the meeting for the first time, and they're like, hey, and I realized, God, we've been shooting for so long, these guys don't know that they haven't met each other before. But and I was shocked, yes, several scenes with Octavia, or many scenes with Riz by that point. They only shared that one scene. Riz, they do have different approaches, but that's also because of the characters they were playing. Riz is super prepared, like, he does so much prep work. Obviously, the physical training, the accent training, the research, speaking to Marine veterans, doing different research into mental health. Even when we got to the States, learning to be good with weapons, and it's all an incredible amount. And so, when in terms of the set, it was very, very focused. It's not like some actors stand up to set and they want to joke with a lot of the crew, because if they can make people laugh, it makes them feel at ease. And maybe Riz does that with other performances, but with this, the type of character he was playing wasn't always, it was quite fraught, traumatized, wounded person. So it wouldn't have helped him to be too relaxed on set. He kind of stayed in character most of the shoot. Which was helpful for me because I could speak directly to the character, but because his character was quite edgy, like when I was asking for the 13th take, and it's like minus 20 degrees on the side of the mountain, and Riz is like, why do you want to do the 13th take? It's a bit, you have to have like your wits around you to be quite precise with what you're asking for, because there was an edge. And then with Octavia, saying that she does a lot of research, but it's very light on the day. It's play, it's fun, it's, she's very, just super, just very easy. Not that Liz isn't, but it's just, it's very detailed and thorough. So it was just like different energies, but both like, director's dream, because they make it very easy for you. You don't really say action with either of them, and you've got six bad takes, and you've got to, you don't need to coax a good performance out of them. The director's relationship with an actor like that is looking for the options, or trying to find a different spectrum of the performance, rather than, oh, look, Riz, this doesn't sound good, it sounds like you're acting. I'll help you, don't worry. It's not really that relationship.
And how did him being character most of the time affect the boys' performance as well? Especially with them being less experienced or like being on a set before form. How do they respond to that?
I think because his character's very warm with them, predominantly, except for that. Once when he explodes, so he wanted to create that very personal paternal bond. And I think it could have just thrown them a bit if he switched to going into his British accent, especially the 7-year-old. I don't know, it would have. In fact, most of the crew thought Riz was British by the end, and that he put on an English accent for the film's actually an elegant. So, but I think it helped with the kids that they just saw him as one person. And he was, again, he was really warm. He wasn't edgy with them, he was very warm with them. We both made a decision, because you have different ways you can direct a kid, and you could, there's ways you might manipulate them, or you could be colder to them on the days that they were supposed to have an argument, or we just thought it wasn't the way that we wanted to work with them, especially because both were their first time on the film. So we thought we want both of us to be, just have a great friendship with them, because the more relaxed they are, the more comfortable, the more chance that they're going to be more comfortable and be able to play themselves. So, and I think he just set the bar of like preparing, doing the work. And even the 7-year-old was then like at home. I don't know if he could read the script, but he got his mum to read the script to him, and he started to want to imitate Riz's, you know, not method, but like turning up for a day's shoot and really trying to work at it. And so it might have helped with that, because not all kids are so professional. You know, they could do a couple of hours work and be like, I don't want to do this anymore. And that could be really problematic.
Yeah.
But luckily, both kids weren't like that. They just turned up every day with like a lot of enthusiasm. And maybe they fed off of, you know, Riz held that. Whereas if Riz was a diva, and he was a difficult personality, which some actors can be, that could have really upended, that could have changed how the kids would have behaved as well. So he sort of set the tempo in a helpful way.
Is there anyone else on the orange hat? Yeah.
So you mentioned that the film was shot during COVID. So did that have any limitations on what you were able to achieve with your vision? Did it cause you to change anything originally? And what were some of the biggest challenges you faced that were brought on because of the situation?
Main thing at the beginning was location, because I scouted in New Mexico and then in Utah, and I wanted to shoot in Utah because it had these otherworldly landscapes, like the desert environments there were just crazy, and I thought, and I love the idea that even when the film transitions out of being a sci-fi and you know it's all in its head, I like that the location would still be evocative of a sci-fi in a way. I loved Utah for that. We had to move it to California because it was safer than traveling all the crew, cast and crew from LA. But we did a bunch of scouting in California and thankfully found just as like stranger locations. In fact, stranger in some way, like the abandoned mining town where they rest up. That was originally going to be a trailer park, like an abandoned trailer park, which could have worked, but we only had the budget to maybe buy 6 trailers and kind of stick them in a rural location. I don't know if it would have looked that great, because when we found that mining town, it kind of ticked all the boxes that we were looking for, where it almost looks like a desert town from a post-apocalyptic movie. It could be featured in Mad Max or something. It also looked like this bombed out vestiges of a conflict zone. We liked that a lot of the landscapes would echo the environments that Riz's character would have gone to, and he was still being haunted by the trauma of those landscapes. Anyway, so it turned out to be better on that front. In terms of the shoot, luckily we didn't have any crowd scenes. The one that we did have was when Octavia's character went to the bowling alley, and there was a lot of pressure put on me to find a different scene with less people. But nothing, I really like this idea that instead of focusing on the detective or the FBI officer, we would focus on the parole officer, because you don't get to see that character's perspective. And I also liked that character was originally a guy, and he was a bit more of an archetype. And I liked that it was a woman that is she's a mother and a wife, and she finishes a hard day's work, and she's got to go to some birthday bowling party, and I liked how sort of the contrast of that location against where Riz's character was taking his voice. So I just couldn't come up with anything that's better. and we just tried to be smart in the way that we shot it, and shot it with long lenses, and I don't know how many people we had, like 12 or something, but we tried to make it look like 30 by staggering them around Octavia. And she was extremely nervous about COVID, as we all were, but she was really, really nervous, and so we had to be careful about the diameter, how close people were to her, and you know, the AD department getting the right people to walk past her at the right time, even though they were like 12 feet away. But other than that, there was no big rewrite or anything. It was just the normal frustrating stuff that we would have to go through, like you wear a mask, you have to, you know, you can't only have a certain amount of people on set. It just slows things down. I found that the hardest, because we were already on a tight schedule, because the kids only had a certain amount of hours on set, because they had to go through school whilst we were shooting. So we had that, plus COVID, plus it being a road movie, you're changing location, and stunts, and special effects. It was just an extra level of stress on the shoot. And then I was like, I'm never making a film during COVID again. I don't know how long we're going to live in COVID, so maybe I'll have to. A lot of the same stuff that you guys are doing when you make shorts. But we didn't. It's not like we had a nightclub scene, and we're like, how do we change this? So yeah, it wasn't too bad.
Yeah, you talked about being anxious. Frank, I'm not anxious, but I mean, when you shot something so big and so huge, do you have so much pressure on yourself? And if that's so, how do you manage to, you know, shoot without so much anxiety about doing so many things? Like, for example, the scene in which all the soldiers surround the car at the end. There was so much stuff going on, I would have just thrown out and, yeah, someone else did my scene, I'm not going to be the director, and we managed to do that. How?
Well, in some way, like, I'd already created that situation in some ways, because I made it, I always feel like it's not certainly not the main job, but one of the side jobs of any department, especially the director, maybe especially the DP, is to elevate the scale of the project that you're working on. So like, you maximize the resources that you have. So I don't know what our budget was in the end, something like $15 million, so maybe that's 11 or 12. So we wanted it to make 12 million pounds, so we wanted it to look like double that. Just as a like, this is what we should be doing as filmmakers, making the canvas as big and making it as immersive for the audience. Same with Beast, we had £1.5 million for that. We wanted to make it look like it was made for £3 million pounds. And so I wasn't seeing that stuff as a problem I had to overcome. It was more like I was already trying to make it as big as, not as big as possible, but trying to stretch our resources as wide as possible. You know, there was one version of it where it was like two cop cars down on a road, and when we didn't get all the money we were originally looking for, that's what it was going to be. And all of the police videos I was looking at from helicopters, it wasn't that, it was like heavily militarized police response units, and so I really pushed to make it, you know, to use these references, these YouTube helicopter videos that I saw of police chases where it just looked like an insane amount of people. So I think that helped in some way, because I was the one that was pushing through it. That's one thing, and then the other thing is just planning it a lot, prepping it, because I bet if you'd gone through all the week's prep leading up to that moment, and you storyboarded it intensely with a storyboard artist and shortlisted it with your DP. We've done pre-production meetings where I had to be in front of the whole crew and take them through every shot, every location, not every angle, but like all of the things that I wanted to be there. then in some, you know, you're going already going into that day knowing what you want to get. So you're not seeing the day as a challenge that you've got to somehow do your job for. You're seeing it as a thing that you're creating. You enjoy it in a way. And what's more frustrating is if you haven't done the prep work, because then you're like, how many people have we got? Why are we shooting there? Do we have another camera? So I think it's the prep work that gives you the confidence. Because if you have it all down on paper, not that we didn't improvise a lot, but if you know what the essence of the scene is and what you want to shoot and where A camera should be and B camera should be, and then you look forward to the challenge of that day. I always felt that there was so much work. I didn't have time to be anxious because we were shooting a lot of that scene over a 1 hour period because it had to be over dusk. Because of course they go on the chase through the sort of daytime or late afternoon and the final scene's at night. So I had to do this standoff and this conversation at dusk. So I didn't really have time to get too anxious. I was just a bit, I was just very driven to get it. You'll be fine once you get
there. And do you think, I don't want to do another question, but do you think that your vision that you had in pre-production is what you got from the movie?
I had already found out with Shorts and with Beast that you don't, film is a living, breathing organism. And, you know, I can't remember who said it, but you write one film, you shoot a second, and you edit a third. And, you know, maybe for certain, you know, for the Alfred Hitchcock style directors, he obviously famously hated shooting because he felt like he'd made it all in his head, and he storyboarded most shots, and it was just kind of laborious for him to turn up every day and have to get it on, in the camera. I think for a lot of directors, that's not the case. You're trying to find new and interesting things on the day. So I'd let go of the version of the film that was in my head when we got into pre-production, because I'm actively looking for how it can be better. And I also want to give actors a lot of room and try and respond to them. When I was at film school, I really had this preconceived notion that a real director is someone that thinks the film from beginning to end, just get that exactly how they see it. And then the more I spoke to directors and the more research I did into directors that I love, whether that's, Paul Thomas Anderson, Martin Scorsese, the more I read about them, found out how much that they, not improvise the movie, but they're really trying to respond to what's in front of them. And they have the confidence to let go of an original plan and follow their instincts, or for the film to follow the actor's instincts. So, I never look back too much on what I initially, how I originally saw it. But you kind of need that to get started. But then I want to, you're in a different house, in a different environment, not in Utah anymore, I'm in California, and I'm with this kid as opposed to, I'm not with Chris Pratt, I'm with Riz Ahmed. It inevitably changes a lot, hopefully for the better.
How's the collaboration with Amazon Studios, in terms of creating freedom mostly?
They were really hands-off. I don't know whether it was because we came to them with the film when it was very developed. It wasn't locked, but it's not like we developed it in-house with Amazon. We developed it with film for. And so when we came to them with the script, we kind of said, "Look, this is it. Are you joining this money to shoot it or not?" And then it doesn't mean they had feedback on the script, but it was modest compared to if we were in asking them to come on for development. And then on the shoot, they were very helpful and supportive. I think they were, if they'd seen the rushes, and they were like, "Oh, we're not convinced by the actors, or we don't think this location works, or we don't like the way you're shooting it." It could have been an issue, but they were supportive. Yeah, of the film, they liked the material. And then in the edit, they were good. Same with film four, like heavily involved in the edit. Like you get 10 weeks to make your director's cut where no one sees it. Maybe on the ninth. On the ninth week, we showed it to our producers, but it was just me and the editor. And then after that, Amazon and film four watching every cut. But it was in the spirit of the film. There was nothing, of course you get feedback sometimes that feels like it comes from left field. But that's the same, I'm sure, if I was an exec on someone else's film and I was given the feedback every couple of weeks, I would caveat some of the feedback with, this might not be right, but here's an idea. So I have a lot of empathy for execs, as long as the spirit is trying to help you make the right film. So it was really good working with them. And then, obviously, because COVID happened, that it's on Amazon is super helpful, because if we did it in the normal way, we were at cinemas this Friday, we could be screwed because there's new variants. How often are you all going to the cinema compared to what it was like before COVID? I think people were still really tentative. So it's been really good on that regard. I think they don't have the major old studios, like the Universal, the Warner Brothers, Fox, and have a heavier creative hand, but with the streamers, it's less so. I think it's the same with it with Netflix. If they dig the material, if they don't, then maybe it's a problem. But yeah, it was good work.
Can you talk about this already a little bit? How different is directing the children versus the adult actors?
It's a good question. I didn't. In some ways, not dramatically. Like I didn't want to feel like I was directing them through. I'm sure I did do a few tricks to like elicit a performance or a moment out of them, but I kind of wanted to treat them like young actors. And I talked, especially the older one, we talked about subtext, and we talked a lot about what was happening between the lines. And a lot of adult actors are guilty of this. They're like waiting, they're acting for them is sometimes waiting for their turn to speak. And you're not, and it means that when you're in the edit, you can't hold on an actor because you're not seeing the thought or the emotion happen. And I thought, well, that could be especially true for a young actor, because to learn to listen as an actor is something that's hard. It's an active thing to do. And so I spent quite a bit of time with the older boy, just talking with him about how much his performance was going to be about listening as it was speaking. I was saying, you're observing your father, you're going through a moment where you look up to this guy like he's a hero, and you're going to find out he's not, he's just a human being, and he needs help, and that's actually heartbreaking. And the film, your performance is only going to work if we're seeing that happening. And he understood all of that. He was like emotionally very mature. And I had to break it down, scene by scene or moment sometimes, which I'll just remind him. But that's why I was very gratified to find in the edit. It was like he was playing the subtext, he wasn't just reading the line, but even in small examples, like when Wiz's character parks up inside the house and he says, "You think I'm making this up?" And of course the kid says no. But the subtext is, I think you're making this whole thing up. I think you might be crazy. But yet, if you didn't think, you had to think that for that to read in his eyes. And so that, I found that very, it wasn't difficult in a way. And then with the younger one, Aditya, sometimes I think his default acting could be a bit like because he watches a lot of cartoons, so he would speak in a cartoon voice. So maybe on the first take or two, I would just have to say, "Need to remember, we're not in a cartoon," and it was just a bit. He's got a really cute voice anyway, but it was really high pitched, and that's just because that's the media that he consumes a lot. So that's how characters speak, and it would be more about getting him to think about how he would react. And we would just roll the cameras a bit longer, wouldn't cut too often. We'd just do it again. Riz and Lucian River, who plays his brother, were very good at improvising, and they knew that we just we just needed to do this scene enough in enough different ways till he got fresh again. And then many times he was great on the first take. So it wasn't, a lot of people told me it was going to be the hardest thing. And in some ways, it was like, it was the thing that made it easier, because COVID was such a doom-laden cloud hanging over the whole shoot. We didn't know if anyone was going to get it. We kept on hearing about films and TV shows being shut down. Everyone's, of course, really worried about their health. And all of the, you know, it was just such a, drained a lot of the fun out of the shoot. We couldn't all finish on Friday and get drunk together. But those two little kids turned up every day, and they had such big smiles and such enthusiasm and so much excitement. And they were just sweet-natured kids. They weren't like difficult children. And I think that their energy infected the whole crew. So halfway through, I thought, God, everyone told me working with the kids was going to be the hardest. The schedule was working with the kids was the hardest, but actually working with them as two individuals was like a big joy of the creative process. But I don't know if that's always the case. Now I might go, okay, I made this one, I like the performances with the kids, I want to work with kids again, because it might not always turn out to, you know, to be that way. So yeah.
You mentioned how like Riz Ahmed was interested, but like was Octavia Spencer kind of like always attached to it, or was that like how did he end up also getting her to work on it?
Yeah, she, when I did a rewrite on the script, that, as I said, that character was originally called Hank, and he was a 60-year-old, I think it was set, might be in Texas at that point. I can't remember where it's set, but quite a character you might have seen before. He was a really well written character, so this isn't a disparagement on Joe's script. It's just that he wrote it nearly 10 years ago now, and the film landscape has changed, and the onus on us as filmmakers in terms of who we populate our films with has changed. And you have a more critical, there's more critical thought process that goes on about who's in the film and who's being represented. I found that that original script that I loved and the characters that I thought were well written, I just thought it was too dude heavy. And at that moment, it's quite, the very red is very white. And so I, before I even cast Riz, I thought, okay, I want to flip that role. And so soon after starting to write on the script, I wrote for her, which is a really dangerous thing to do, because 9 times out of 10 you won't get the actor that you're writing a part for. But I just thought, I just somehow had her voice in my head, and when I was, after I cast Riz and we were going to actually cast her part, I wrote her a letter and I said, look, I've written this part for you and I've been hearing your voice for a year and a half, and here are the reasons that I want you to play this character. And a week later, she rung me up and she was like, hey, I want to do the movie. Like, when do we start? And I thought it was going to be a much more drawn-out process, that I might have to fly to Los Angeles to meet her and pitch the movie to her. And it was just lucky. It was just a lucky movie. It might never happen again that way. And yeah, it was the easiest part to cast, because it was just an email that I wrote her and I sent her.
Had you met her before, because you were the BAFTAs together the same year?
Octavia?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I hadn't. No, I'd met Riz at the BAFTAs, but no, I didn't, really briefly. But not Octavia. But now we're looking for something to do together.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah, so, yeah, she was definitely a fun one. I mean, she was so fun. The whole cast and crew were like, looked at the schedules and like, oh my God, Octavia's come today. And everyone would be like grouped around her trailer, because there was just so much laughter. She just brings a cooler energy to, you know, obviously filmmaking is quite stressful, and she helps diffuse a lot of that stress.
That's how I'd expect it to be. That's
not yeah.
Does anyone else have any questions? Can I just get a quick time check?
Yes.
Oh, okay. We'll finish up after this question.
Yeah, no, I really like the simplicity of like the title and how it kind of like lends itself to like multiple readings. You kind of like go into it of it being like an alien encounter. You watch a bit more and it's perhaps an encounter that he's had in his mental breakdown or whatever, or perhaps a marine, and then at the end it's a father and son encounter and whatnot. And so I was sort of wondering if that was always the original title and what you take from the title itself.
It was originally called Invasion, and then halfway through shooting, we heard there was an Apple TV show called Invasion coming out, and we didn't, during the edit, we weren't sure whether that, because I've never seen it, but I think I've seen a trailer, it's quite VFX heavy, and we thought we might have a shot at our film coming out first, and thus it would be their problem for them need to change it, but their trailer came out first and their release date. And we didn't obviously want to confuse an audience with, it would be crazy to have two things coming out at the same time with the same title. So we had to think of a new title, and it was the hardest thing. I don't know if you guys have found this. We almost did it with these. We were thinking about changing the title. We came up with hundreds, and they were all terrible. They all sounded like bad airport novels. I mean, I'd be too embarrassed to even give you few of them. They were like, they weren't bad, they were just bland. Like one was, which I just thought sounded like a Liam Neeson action. And luckily we didn't call it The Bessie, because there's a film about there's a documentary that's supposed to be really good about the Thailand, the kids got stuck in the cave and they had to. So thank God we didn't call it The Rescue. Then I landed on Encounter because I was trying to come up with something that had the same way that Invasion evokes Invasion of the Body Snatchers, I wanted something to evoke the title of a seminal sci-fi film. And I thought it would speak to this idea of one, his Marine past, and how Marines literally talk about encountering enemy combatants. So I had that flavour to it. And ultimately, it was about him encountering himself and really understanding that he's someone that has a problem. He has a vulnerability, and he has to show that to his child. And him and his child really, just start encountering and talking to each other, honestly, for the first time. So I liked the different levels of it. But we only came up with that the day before we had to release the title of the film, Telluride, where it was going to premiere. Amazon were pushing The Rescue, and then I tell you why you would have had two for the Rescue, the documentary premiere there as well. You would have had two titles called The Rescue. It would have been a total nightmare. We created it, but it took a long, long time.
And last question.
Hi, I just really wanted to ask you, what can you expect from your
Yeah, I've got this really bad work ethic where I don't know what I'm doing after I finish the. Some direct friends of mine are so good because they got like a slate of projects. They worked on two TV things, like one small film, a massive movie. They're writing something on their own, and I never have anything after I finish. Like, I finish these, so I'm like, what do I do? And I finish this, and I'm like, what do I do? So every day I'm just reading scripts that come in, or reading books, or talking to writers, having meetings with production companies. All I know is that I want to play in the same way that both Beast and Encounter are like using genre to do a character portrait of some very conflicted and flawed, complicated person. I know I want to continue doing that, because I like, it feels quite rare to. Either films are generally like drama or they're genre, and I quite like the films that straddle, both of those worlds. So, yeah, I'm not sure yet. Hopefully, if I don't find an idea by April, I'm in trouble. I'll be broke. I'm giving myself like a few months to reach.